source and the resistor, A to B, and my first action is not going to be to simplify it, but to rewrite it in a different representation. My goal with this process is to simplify circuits, but as part of that, I need to show you some skills that we'll use to do that, and the very first skill is to replace this circuit with something that's equivalent, and what I mean by equivalent is somebody electrically could not tell the difference. There's no measurement you can make to it that would allow Edgardo to tell the difference between this circuit and the one I'm going to draw on the right. So suppose I've got maybe a 5-amp current source and a 6-ohm resistor. I claim that I can replace this circuit with a circuit that instead of having a current source, has a voltage source. And instead of being in parallel with the resistor, is in series with the resistor. So I claim that this circuit and this circuit are the same if I pick this voltage source just right, and I pick the size of that resistor just right. Now that shouldn't be surprising. When I claimed that the two resistor networks had to be the same, I was obviously only claiming that was true if I picked the right value. So to claim that the resistor I drew up here, that clump of resistors was the same thing as 3/5, that obviously only was true if I replaced it with a resistor size that was 3/5. I couldn't replace it with any old resistor size. So here, this can be equivalent to that if I pick the right voltage source and the right size resistor. I need to make it so that nobody could tell the difference between these two circuits. This version of the source, with the current source and the resistor in parallel with it, is going to be called the Norton equivalent, and the version with the voltage source and the resistor is going to be called the Thevenin equivalent. I'm worried now that there's a little accent over one of the E's or something like that. What I'll do is I'll draw it really light so you can't tell if it's a smudge mark or an accent. Okay, so this is going to be the same points, A and B. Okay, so I need to make sure these two circuits behave exactly the same. So I'll maybe do the first half of this and see if you can help me with the second half. One measurement I'm going to make on this circuit right here, I'm going to take two probes of a voltmeter, and I'm going to measure the voltage between A and B. If I measure the voltage drop between A and B for the circuit on the left, how much voltage will I measure?
5 volts?
No.
30.
30 volts.
And why 30, Isaac?
Because it's B equals IR, 5 from 6.
Okay, so this 5 amps has nowhere to go but through that 6 ohm resistor. So I'll have 5 amps flowing through the 6 ohm resistor. So I will have a 30 volt drop across the 6 ohm resistor. So when I measure between A and B, I'm going to get 30 volts. So those of you who are thinking 30, that's correct. What if I measure it here? What voltage am I going to read?
Zero.
No. 30 also. What if I measured here to here? What am I going to get?
Zero.
How about there to there?
There
to there.
Zero.
There to there.
Zero.
Okay, good. So I get 30 volts here to here. I come over here and I measure the voltage between A and B. I better get what value?
30.
If I get anything other than 30, then this circuit's not the same as that circuit. Okay, so I better get 30. What does that tell me about what that voltage has to be?
30 volts.
Bigger than
30? Roger's saying it's got to be 30. James is saying it's got to be maybe a little bigger than 30 because I might lose some voltage across that resistor. If I have a perfect voltmeter, I touch the two probes, does a voltmeter easily let current flow through it or not let current flow through it? It's kind of one of those things we have to keep track of.
Not much.
A voltmeter does not let current go through it.
It has a high resistance.
Has a very high resistance. So in practice, in the real world, a teeny bit of current will go through a voltmeter. And I think that's kind of what James is saying. It's not perfect. If I actually connected a real-world voltmeter, a little bit of current would go through it, and I'd have to take that into account. On the blackboard, I can connect such a thing as an ideal voltmeter. My ideal voltmeter has no current going through it at all. So when I touch my probes here to here, how much current flows through the resistor? If there's no current at all flowing through the voltmeter?
Zero,
but you all seem pretty unsure of that. So if I have no current flowing through the voltmeter, then there can't be any current flowing through that resistor. If there's no current flowing through the resistor, what's the voltage drop across the resistor?
Zero.
So the reading I'll get on the voltmeter will match exactly the voltage drop across that voltage source. So if the reading I get on the voltmeter is 30 volts, what must that battery be? How much voltage?
30.
So this, make these two equivalent, that's got to be a 30-volt battery. Can you suggest an experiment, something I could do? I've already measured the voltage. What else might I do that might help me figure out what size resistor I need to put there to make these two circuits equivalent? This circuit, what I would do is connect a perfect ammeter. There's a perfect ammeter. How much resistance will a perfect ammeter have?
Zero,
correct. So for the circuit on the left, if I came over here and connected a perfect ammeter to it, so that's basically like connecting a wire, no resistance at all. Perfect ammeter, then that 5 amp current source, that 5 amps, how much of that's going to go through the wire?
All of it.
So what reading will that ammeter read? 5 amps, correct. So if I connected a perfect ammeter there, it's going to read 5 amps. So I'm going to then connect the same perfect ammeter over here. If these two circuits are equivalent, what should that ammeter read?
5 amps.
5 amps. I agree. So that better read 5 amps. And it's a perfect ammeter, so it's acting like it's just a straight wire. Okay. So maybe if I'm worried, I'll confuse a little bit by drawing an ammeter picture there. So connecting a perfect ammeter is just like connecting a straight, perfect wire there. Can you figure out what size that resistor has to be now to make that ammeter read 5 amps?
6 ohms.
6 ohms. Correct. Okay, so now my claim, I haven't proved it, but my claim is that nobody can tell the difference between these two circuits. There's nothing you could do that would distinguish these two circuits electrically. There is one thing you could do, but it's not really an electrical experiment. I could put both of them in a tub of water, and this circuit, since it has no current flowing through it, there's nothing connected to it. There's no current flowing through it, so this one's not heating anything up. This circuit on the left here, though, there's always some current flowing through it, so it's going to be constantly producing heat. So this one, technically, might be able to tell based on measuring how much heat is produced by the two circuits. But let's not worry about that. That's not really an electrical experiment. What I mean is there's no voltage or current I can measure here versus there that would allow you to tell the difference between the two. Let me test this theory, though, just by placing a 3-ohm resistor on the edge of this circuit, and we'll place a 3-ohm resistor on the side of that circuit. And for both circuits, I will calculate the voltage drop across that 3-ohm resistor, and I will see if it's the same for both circuits. Let's do the circuit on the right, and let's use voltage division, and let's go to Edgardo. circuit on the right.